Okay, so let's start. This is Seung Yoo Kim. Hi. I know this week is the midterm exam, right? So midterm exam week. So how was your midterm exam? I mean, not this course, but your other courses. So, as you know, this course will have a final exam. So as you expect, it's going to be really large coverage if you don't start earlier. So I strongly suggest you please start as fast as possible. Okay, so from last week, we started the training on neural network. So today's part two. Well, let's recap part one. Okay. So here's the overview. Image classification problem. We have a training set with the image xn and class label yn. First of all, we have to fix our neural network architecture. Something like the what's that? The formally VGNet or the lessNet, something like this. And we also have to consider the loss function and how to update our gradient and how to compute the gradient things or the how to stabilize our training page and the task, how to improve the testing accuracy and transfer learning. So last week, we discussed stabilization things and some architectures. So last week we discussed the activation functions and data pre-processing and weight initialization and batch normalization and babysitting the learning rate or the learning process and hyperparameter optimization. So yeah, there was the six kinds of activation functions: sigmoid function, tangent function, ReLU function, LeQ-ReLU, maxout, and ReLU. So sigmoid functions keys numbers to range 0 to 1. So historically, it was very popular because they have a nice interpretation as saturating final rate of the neuron. So the sigmoid function defined looks like this, but there were three kinds of problem, right? So first problem was the gradient vanish problem. So because the, okay, if you think about the sigmoid gate, I mean the sigmoid function here, here's the input signal x and output signal, in this case the sigma x, to update, to backpropagate our loss gradient to the other connected neuron, we have to consider the local gradient, right? So this is the upstream gradient, and this was the downstream gradient, and this is the local gradient. But as you can see here, the local gradient, the local gradient of the sigmoid function, it's going to be really small, right? So here was the example. So in this part, this part and this part, the local gradient of sigmoid function is going to be zero, even though here, our output, our inputs are here, the our local gradient is going to be really small, right? It's really smaller than the one. So when x is the input x is equal to 10 or the negative 10, the local gradient is going to be converged to the zero. So it's going to be saturation problem. So that will be the gradient vanish problem with the sigmoid function. Another limitation was the sigmoid output are not zero centered. So yeah, here was that. So when we derived our loss gradient with respect to the weight function, the weight wi, the derivation looks like this. So they are all connected to the single output value, the single loss gradient with respect to p1. And if the output of the sigmoid function at the previous layer Okay, so if x is an output of the sigmoid function at the previous layer, x is larger than 0, right? So in this case, the gradient on w always all positive or whole negative, depending on the loss gradient with respect to p. So due to the this kind of limitation, there is going to be the zigzag path problem where the how to say the it is really hard to optimize when optimal W vector was something like this. When W one star is larger than zero, and W two was smaller than zero, then it's going to be probabilistic, right? So final limitation was the exponential term. So as you know, exponential term is a bit computer expensive, right? So sigmoid function was something like this. There was another activation function. First one is the tangent function. Tangent function generate the zero-centered output, but still it killed the gradient when saturated. So yeah, saturated, and the exponential term is a bit compute expensive as well. So I told you the ReLU function or rectified linear unit is one of the most popular one to increase the depth of our neural network or the convolutional neural network. The advantage of the ReLU function was that it does not saturate in positive region, and it is very computation efficient compared to the sigmoid or the tangent function. It approximately converges much faster than sigmoid or tangent function in practically 6 times better. It's actually more biologically plausible than sigmoid function. But ReLU function is not zero-centered also, and it annoys when input x is smaller than zero. This part. So when output is smaller than zero, this parameter w will never update. So this is the limitation of the ReLU function. So to overcome this limitation, there are another variant. So first one is leakage ReLU function. In this case, the activation function also defined in negative region, something like this. In this case, this alpha value could be updated, could be trained during the training time. Another one is the exponential linear unit one, or just called the ELU term, but because it has the exponential term, so it's going to be computationally heavy. So another one is the MAXA function. Yeah, it generalized the ReLU or the liquid ReLU well, and it is a linear regime, so it does not saturate and it does not die, so it's going to be really great choice, but it doubled the number of parameter or neuron, so it also have the another limitation. So practicing activation function, use the ReLU function, it's going to be the good default choice. Of course, you can try other techniques, something like the liquid ReLU or the method or ELU. And final suggestion was that don't use the sigmoid or tangent, okay? We also talked about the data processing, right? So after normalization, our input signal is going to be our input data less sensitive to the small change in the weight. So it will be easier to optimize. Generally, the mean and variance are frequently used, but you may also see the PCA or the whitening of the data looks like this. So in image processing or the computer vision field, subtract mean, subtract the per-channel mean, or the subtract the per-channel mean, and divide by per-channel standard deviation are common. Actually, it is not common to normalize the variance to do the PCA or the whitening. Another thing was the weight initialization, right? So as you can see here, if the initialization, I mean the when W was zero, the output, I mean the intermediate activation map is going to be zero or constant. So it's not a desirable phenomena. So proper initialization is an active area of the research. For example, like the random initialization and Javier initialization and ReLU initialization, things like this. So lastly, we also discussed some case study of the weight initialization. The first idea was the very small random noise. I mean the very small random number. For example, like the zero mean and the 0.01 standard deviation, something like this. But it works okay for small network, but problem with a deeper network. So I gave you some some examples of the weight initialization. When the parameter, the random initialized parameter are really small, the each activation map, each hidden node values is going to be really small. So in this case, there will be the null learning. Why? Because if you remember the just a linear function thing, x times w times h, so w is going to be the learnable parameter during neural network or the convolution neural network. Then backpropagation term like this one defined looks like this. Loss gradient with respect to the s times x transpose, right? So as I mentioned before, the x transpose is going to be really small. So this term is going to be zero, right? So there will be the no learning anymore. Another possible solution is to increase the learning rate as a 1 instead of the 0.01. But in this case, almost the whole neuron completely saturated, either minus 1 or, or 1, something like this or this or this. Of course, there will be the neural learning, right? Because the each module are saturated, so there is no learning anymore. So purple random initialization was really important. So the Javier initialization, they actively define the weight, something like this. Rather than just constant value one, they use the square of the dimension of the square root of the dimension of input value. Okay, so there was the reason. So when we compute the variance of the output s, in this case, okay, this was x, like this. Then we can derive the variance with respect to the w and x, right? So as you can see here, when we define the variance of w as a 1 over n, then the variance of the x is going to be approximately same as the variance of the s, I mean the variance of the input. So we can make our initial loss gradient stably. But when we use the ReLU nonlinearity function, it will be predicted. So in other words, the activation collapse to zero again, so there will be no learning. So there was another one, the MSRA initialization or the head initialization. So they additionally add the division with two. So by using this kind of thing, they dramatically improve the stability of the neural network training scheme. So to summarize, the weight initialization, when initialization was too small, there will be no learning. And initialization was too big, there will be no learning as well. And then we have to choose the proper, how to say, proper value of the initialization. So nice to make the nice distribution of the activation at whole layers. Okay, so we also talked about the batch normalization thing. How was that? It to overcome the internal covariance shift problem. So how we can make our activation distribution as a Gaussian form? How can we do that? We can just normalize with the zero. We can just normalize with the mean and variance. Looks like this one. So this is just a simple normalization thing within. At the intermediate neural network. So here was that. So in original batch normalization, we normalize the activation map across the. Across the instances within the one batches. So we have to compute the per-channel mean and per-channel variance and normalize original input data. But there was a problem, right? So what if the zero mean unit variance is too hard to constrain? So we have to think about another term. So in batch normalization, they train the scale and shift parameter, lambda and beta, and retransform to the normalized activation map to the another domain, the another space. So in test time, this estimation, the zero mean and covariance depend on the training time learning average. So in other words, during test time, batch norm becomes a linear operator, so can be fused to with the previously connected or convolution layer. So in general, the batch normalization layer is inserted after fully connected or the convolution layer before nonlinearity layer. So it make a deep network much easier to train and improve the gradient flow and allows a higher learning rate and the faster convergence and network becomes more robust to initialization and act as a regularization during training. We will discuss regularization today, the part two, but yeah, batch norm is the very powerful regularization technique during the training. And one more thing is that it almost has a zero overhead at testing time, so it can be fused with the convolution. But as I told you, it behaves differently during training and testing. So please be careful when you use the batch normalization module. And of course, there are other normalization things, for example, like the layer norm or the instance norm or group normalization thing, right? I told you it depends on the application. For example, you are interested in the style transfer or the instance image to image translation thing, something like that. Then instance normalization is the better choice than batch normalization or the layer normalization. Okay, so we also discussed the learning rate. Learning rate was the hyperparameter in our neural network. So as I told you, we can adjust or we can annulling the learning rate during the iteration, or as evolving the epoch in our neural network training. Very common things was stepwisely reduce the learning rate. So this is the examples in the lesson. They apply the learning rate by 0.1 after epoch 30, 60, 90. Another one is to linearly reducing the learning rate, like this one. So this technique was used in the BERT paper and the BERT architecture. Another one is the inverse square root things. Finally, we also talked about the hyperparameter, and In neural network or the convolutional neural network, there are so many hyperparameters. For example, like the network architecture. In network architecture, there are number of kernels and number of channels, the stride, padding, depth, or something like this. And of course, we also have the learning rate and its decay schedule, decay constant, or the update type, or the regularizer strength, or the what's it? Regularization parameter thing, something like this. So here was the some tips or trick. Single validation cell rather than multiple port. Search on the log scale for the learning rate first, and search the fine region by using the coarse-fine search technique. So I gave you some example. So first of all, run coarse search for the 5-apple, and then run final search. So we can get the relatively good accuracy for the same network. Another thing is the greedy search process, the random search. As you can see here, I mean the right-hand side, by performing the random search, we can more precisely discover the good values, I mean the good hyperparameter values for the important one. So final one was the monitor and the visualize the horoscope to check the our training, how to say training, training phenomena or the training tendency. So if there is a overfitting, we can increase the regularization strength. Or if there is a gap between the training and validation accuracy, we can just to reduce the model capacity. Or just, we can increase the model capacity. So this it was part one. Okay, so let's move on to the part two. Okay, so today we are going to talk about the training on neural network, I mean the part two. Today we are going to discuss the compute the gradient and how to improve the testing accuracy and how to transfer our pre-trained model to the our new neural application. Okay, let's start with computing the gradient. Question so far?
엄청 빨리 넘어온 것 같은데 그 제가 두 번째 저번 시간에 두 번째 파트는 유튜브에 올려놨어요. 그쵸? 그래서 혹시 안 보신 분들은 안 본 분들이 좀 있는 것 같아요. 보니까 조회수를 보니까 아마 안 보신 분들도 있는데 꼭 아마 시험 기간이라 바빠서 못 봤을 것 같은데 꼭 저번 시간에 후반부 챕터 한번 보시기를 바랍니다. 오케이. So, okay, let's start with the general one convolution module.
Okay, generally, one convolution module consisting of the convolution layer, optionally with the batch normalization and nonlinear mapping, nonlinear activation mapping function, or and the pooling layer, right?
Let's say input is xn, output is xn prime. And we already know there is a runnable parameter w and bias in the convolution layer. And in batch normalization layer, there are lambda and beta, right? The linear transform parameter. And in nonlinear activation function, there is no runnable parameter, right? If we use the ReLU function.
And if we just use the max pooling, there's no random parameter, right?
그 제가 좀 우리가 다 배웠던 것들은 빠르게 넘어가고 있고 조금 저번 시간에 다뤘던 건 정말 빠르게 좀 넘어가고 있으니까 혹시 질문 있으면 중간중간에 해주시면 좋겠습니다. 알겠죠?
Okay, so in this one convolution module, we have to find out the loss gradient.
with respect to the W, MP, and lambda, beta, right? From the upstream gradient to downstream gradient. So these kinds of things can be used to update, right? So how can you do that? So to implement this one, I told you we have to compute the local gradient, right? Local gradient. So today, let's think about how to compute, how to update convolution parameter, and how to backpropagate the max pooling layer. These two kinds of things. We discussed this term, I mean this layer, in the last lecture. So please check this one. Today, let's think about the convolution layer things and the max pooling things. Okay. First of all, so the convolution was the dot product between filters and local region of the input, right? So when we draw the figure, activation map, there is a cone of things like this one, and it's going to be the output, right? This is a one convolution cone. So if you remember properly, just the one convolution is the dot product between the filter and local region of the input, or the chunk of the data. So we can say that convolution is the convolution layer is the forward path of the convolution the forward path of the convolution layer as a one big matrix multiplication. Okay, let's think about this one. So let's say we have an input data, something like this. It might be the input image, right? Let's assume that we have a combo filter, 96 filters of the 11 by 11 by 3 with stride 4 and padding 0. Okay. So the first of all, our runnable parameter W will be defined in 96 times 11 times 11 times 3, right? This is just a tensor, right? And output shape is going to be the spatial resolution of output is going to be the 55. So output tensor size is going to be the 55 by 96. Okay. So in this case, it's going to be 227, 227, 3, and 11 by 11 by 3, but there will be the 96 one cases, and the output size is going to be 55 by 55 by 96 1. Okay. So how can we represent this one convolution as a one big matrix multiplication? Here is the idea. First, convert the input. Let's say this is x into a x call by taking a block of the 11 by 11 by 3 pixels in the input for the 50 by 50 times. So let me draw this one. So 네, 영준 학생 질문해 주시죠. 네, 질문하셔도 됩니다. 이렇게 like this. So we can just copy the x value here like this one. There will be the 55 by 50 times column, number of columns. So it's going to look like this one. Okay, this is the matrix form of the input tensor, I mean the input tensor x. Okay. Is there any question? 영준? 영준 학생? 질문 있으신가요? 간이 나왔네요, 간. 그렇죠. 간은 아직 우리 안 배웠죠? 어쨌든 봅시다. 간이 배치넘에 적합하지 않다는 논문도 있고, 배치 노멀라이제이션을 적용해야 잘 된다는 말도 있는데 그 근거가 무엇인지 궁금합니다. 이 얘기는 조금 넘어가긴 하는데 결론부터 얘기하면은 이제 우리가 그 간이란 네트워크 어드버서리얼하게 트레이닝 한다는 게 엄청 언스테이블하다고 알려져 있죠. 그렇죠? 그래서 우리가 이 간을, 그러니까 간 페이퍼가 2014년도에 처음 나온 이후로 사실 이 간이라는 게 엄청나게 사실 우리가 적용할 수 있는 게 많다는 것도 알고 있지만 그만큼 이게 트레이닝이 어렵다는 것도 매우 잘 알려진 문제였어요. 그렇죠? 그래서 이 간의 트레이닝 과정 어떻게 스테이블하게 할수 있을까에 대한 수많은 연구들이 나왔고 수많은 이제 노력들이 나왔는데 사실 대부분의 방법들이 실험적이었던 게 많았던 것 같아요. 뭐 DC간이라든지 우리가 뭐 가장 대표적으로 간을 스테이블하게 트레이닝할 수 있는 첫 번째 거의 이미지 제너레이션 첫 번째 페이퍼였던 DC간 같은 경우는 사실 수많은 네트워크 구조들을 바꿔가면서 뭐 스트라이드 컨브로 바꾸어서 그러니까 어떤 게 있었죠? 그뭐 바이너리 업 샘플링을 뭐 컴프 트랜스포를 바꾼다든지 뭐 다양한 테크닉들을 여러 가지 해보면서 가장 스테이블하게 간을 학습해야 되는 걸 연구를 했었죠. 그렇죠. 사실 그래서 질문해 준 거에 따르면은 뭐 제너레이터 또 디스크리미터에 구성된 컨볼루션들의 배치놈을 붙이는 게 좋다는 페이퍼도 있고 안 좋다는 페이퍼도 있는데 사실 그 이유를 딱히 정의해서 말하기 힘들 것 같아요. 다시 얘기하면 이론적으로는 각 제너레이터 또는 디스크리미터에 존재하는 디스크리미터 학습된 액티베이션 맵들이 코베런트 시프트가 잘안 된다고 잘 노멀라이저 되기를 바란다는 측면에서는 배치놈을 쓰는 게 당연히 좋다고 알려져 있지만 어쨌든 어드버서리얼 트레이닝한다는 거는 새들 포인트를 찾는 거잖아요. 그러니까 제너레이터에 대해서는 맥스를 찾는 거고, 맞나? 맥스를 찾는 거고, 디스크리미터에 대해서는 민을 찾는 거잖아요. 그 새들 포인트를 찾는다는 관점에서는 배치노멀라이저를 써서 노멀라이즈를 하는 게 항상 좋다고 할수 없을 수도 있을 것 같아요. 근데 이제 이 이유에 대해서 제가 정확하게 딱 설명을 할 수는 없을 것 같아요. 뭐 실험적인 게큰것 같아요. 간 트레이닝에서는 혹시 답변이 됐는지 모르겠는데 이건 제가 한 번만 더 찾아보고 제가 말씀드릴게요. 혹시 여기 간 연구하시는 분 있나요? 혹시 답변해 줄수 있는 사람? 이거 저도 한 번만 더 생각해 보고 알려줄게요. Okay, so let's continue. Okay, we can convert our input data x into the x column, I mean the matrix form of the x. Then we can also reshape the convolution filter as a W law. It's going to be 96 times 363. 96 times 363, right? It's going to be the each filter. 1 filter is here, right? So, with this kind of representation, I mean the this kind of the input representation and common representation, we can just implement convolutional operation as a matrix multiplication. Define the rules like this. So in this case, the output, I mean the matrix multiplication output is going to be the 96 times the 3025 with the reshaped convolution filter and the input x directly. So finally, we can reshape this output as a 55 by 96. Okay. Then how can I use this kind of new operation? How can I do that? So here's the idea. So, okay, if you remember our quiz 1 and quiz 2, the quiz 2, we discussed how to backpropagate in linear projection case in fully connected module where the neural network, it was looks like this. When x is here, Runner parameter wp here, output z here, the loss gradient with respect to the x, and with respect to the W, and the bias also looks like this, right? We already know how to do that, right? Then, in convolution neural network case, the convolution layer case, we can do similar thing with the matrix multiplication notation. Okay, let's do that. So, first of all, let's think about the single case. The single matrix multiplication case. One filter with one chunk of the data here and generate one output. One D output vector. So in this case, the input XP. So, okay. Let's redraw X cool. It was something like 363 times x prime or x cool, and w was 96 times 363. It's going to be w. It's going to be 1p prime, xp prime, and p prime is going to look like this. Of course, it's 11 by 11 by 3 by 1, right? I told you, don't consider the tensor shape of the tensor. Don't be stuck with the size of tensor shape. 제가 이거 항상 저번부터 얘기했었던 건데, 자, convolutional neural net 할 때 사이즈를 잘 생각하는 게 너무 중요하다고 했지만, 절대 사이즈 를 고정해서 생각할 필요가 없다고 했어요. 고정해서 생각하지 말라는 게 뭐냐면 우리가 이러한 chunk of data를 1년 by 1년 by 3이라고도 표현할 수 있지만 사실 363 by 1로도 표현할 수가 있는 거예요. 그렇죠? 어쨌든 우리가 어떠한 notation, 즉 저거를 4D tensor로 표현하든 1D vector로 표현하든 어차피 우리가 사용하고 있는 library 안에서 저걸 계산하는 거는 어차피 저 per element wise하게 계산이 되는 거죠. 우리가 뭐 파이토치 라이브를 쓰고 텐서플로우도 쓰고 뭐 케라스 여러 가지 쓰겠지만 실제 그 내부에서는 포문을 돌면서 모든 엘러먼트 단위로 사실 인디펜던트가 계산이 들어가는 것뿐인 거예요. 그렇죠? 그렇기 때문에 우리가 이해의 편의성을 위해서 또는 노테이션의 편의성을 위해서 저렇게 텐서 쉐입에 대한 고민들을 많이 하겠지만 절대 저 쉐입에 대해서 이게 뭐 3x 1년 by 11을 쓰여 있다고 해서 내가 이해했던 거와 다른데 나는 그렇게 생각하시면 안 된다고 얘기해 드렸습니다. Another thing is that W parameter, W parameter here. One more thing was the bias term. Right? Here's bias, 96, bias B. And this kind of thing can generate the output, ZP. So the size of ZP is 96 times 1. 96 times 1. So this is a one linear projection thing in the convolution layer. Okay, so for each neuron, I mean this single case, loss gradient with respect to the x prime p, it's going to be looks like this here. Loss gradient with respect to the w, it's going to look like this from here. And this one is going to be looks like this from here, right? So in this case, we already know the p defined from 1 to 3025, right? 3025. Or the 55 by 55. 55 by 55, right? So this is the one backpropagation rule. So this is a backpropagation rule for each neuron in one convolution layer, right? 자, 여기까지 무슨 얘기하고 있는지 다 따라하고 있죠? 무슨 내용인지 따라하고 있죠? 뭔 얘기를 하고 있는 거냐면은 우리가 이제 컨볼루션을 정의를 내렸는데 우리가 앞에서까지 뉴럴넷에서 리니어 프레션에 대해서 미분을 하고 백프로파이션 하는 거에 대해서 배웠어요. 그렇죠? 근데 이제 컨볼루션이라는 걸 어떻게 하느냐? 컨볼루션이라는 게 이제 스트라이딩 윈도우를 돌면서 이렇게 다 계산을 하는데 이걸 이제 우리가 백프로파이션 하려면 로컬 그레디언트 계산해서 업스트림 그레디언트, 업스트림 다운스트림 그레디언트를 고려해서 이제 계산들을 해야 되는데 사실 컨볼루션이 너무 복잡하다 이거죠. 왜 복잡하냐면 이 카피된 이 똑같은 컨볼루션 커널이 스페셜로 쉐어드하게 도는 것도 있고 걔네들이 도는 커널들이 커널이 곱해지는 어떤 chunk of data, 로컬 데이터들이 쉐어드가 리던던트하게 엮여 있는 거죠. 무슨 얘기냐면 이 다음 픽셀을 계산하기 위해서는 이런 픽셀을 계산하는 거죠. 이런 데이터가 계산이 되는 거고 이러한 경우에 이런 컨볼루션 자체로 백프로파이션을 계산하기 매우 어려워진 적. 그래서 이제 이걸 어떻게 이해할 수 있냐면 이제 컨볼루션 자체를 매트릭스 멀티플리케이션 나타낼 수가 있다면 우리는 이제 우리가 매트릭스 멀티플리케이션에서 백프로파게이션 우리가 이전에 배웠던 뉴럴넷에서 배웠던 백프로파게이션을 그대로 컨볼루션 뉴럴넷 컨볼루션 레이어에도 적용이 가능하다라는 점이었고요. 그래서 첫 번째 케이스 가장 아주 간단한 이치 뉴런 그러니까 즉 이 하나의 1D 벡터 아웃풋을 내기 위해서는 이제 다음과 같은 식으로 정의가 된다는 걸 우리가 이전에 example에서 바로 알 수가 있는 거죠. 그렇죠? Okay, what about this? So, let's think about the full neuron case. So, as you know, one convolutional module can convolve the filter across the special field, something like this one, and generate the new output, new activation map. Okay, let me think about how to do that. Okay, so x prime in the 63 times 3025, right? Of course, it is the tensor shape. It has a tensor shape, looks like this one. We already know the Ronald parameter w and bias in the this one convolution layer and output, it's going to be looks like this. Okay. Let me think of loss gradient with respect to the full x prime and the full convolutional corner, I mean the large W and the bias B. Okay, how can you do that? From here, we can directly derive this loss gradient. W prime times loss gradient with respect to the z, I mean the output z, right? It's very easy. But what about this case? What about this case? Even though we consider the all neuron case, the number of parameter, I mean the number of shared parameter, I mean number of the parameter in the convolution or the bias is going to be same. Why? Because the one kernel are shared across the spatial domain, looks like this. So In other words, we have to aggregate the loss gradient across the special resolution. Okay? Because the same convolution kernel are used in the whole special resolution, whole special domain, so we have to aggregate, or the, we have to compute the summation of the loss gradient with respect to the single W and single bias. So here's the equation. So comparing to the this one, we have to aggregate this one across the special domain, in this case P. So it's going to be looks like this one. And this bias loss gradient case, in this case, we have to aggregate. We have to aggregate this one across the special domain. So it's going to be looks like this. Okay. So aggregate. Aggregate across channel, across a special channel. Special channel. Okay. So finally, now we have a loss gradient with respect to x prime. So it's going to be looks like this one. Why? Because the size of x prime was the 363 times 3025, right? And we can reshape this one into the 11 by 11 by 3 times 5 by 5 by 5 tensor, then accumulate it into the this one. What does it mean? Here we have a local loss gradient. This chunk of data and this chunk of data. So this part, I mean the this part. We have to accumulate the local gradient, I mean loss gradient from the blue one and red one, right? So we have to accumulate it into the original size of the data. So original size is going to be 227 by 227 by 3, right? What about the W and bias? We have to reshape X into the X prime, something like this, and reshape the upstream gradient here as a this one. And final output, final loss gradient with respect to W and bias, it's going to be the 96 times 363 and 96 times 1 itself. Okay, so this is the local gradient. This kind of thing can be used to update the convolution module. Update the convolution module. Okay, so this is the backpropagation in convolution layer. What about pooling layer? Okay, let me draw the pooling layer again. It has a local window, looks like this one. Let me say max values choose here and here and here. Going to be the output of the max pooling layer. Let's say this is x and this is y, and we have a loss gradient with respect to y, and we have to compute the loss gradient with respect to the x of downstream gradient and upstream gradient. And max pooling case, we only route the gradient to the input that has the highest value in the first path. So we can just copy this gradient, loss gradient, to here and here. Copy the data. So to do this then, it is common to keep track of the index of the max activation during the first path. Okay. So this is the propagation of the mass pooling maker. It's very intuitive, right? Okay. So far, we discussed how to backpropagate the one convolution module pooling layer, nonlinear activation map layer, convolution layer. Actually, we didn't discuss the batch normalization layer backpropagation. So please think of
what kinds of the technique can be used to backpropagate across the backpropagate the local loss gradient via batch normalization module. Okay? 이거 한번 생각해 봐요. 사실 복잡해요. 그래서 뭐 쓰기도 힘들 수도 있는데 한번 관심 있는 친구들은 해봐요. 근데 어차피 결론은 다 똑같아요. 이 모듈이 정해지는 순간 모듈에 안에서 일어나는 오퍼레이션이 정해지는 순간 걔의 로컬 그레디언트만을 찾을 수 있으면 사실 우리가 말했던 거 다 풀 수가 있는 거죠. 그럼 과연 배치 노멀리전 레이어의 로컬 그레디언트가 뭘까? 우린 시간 관계상 넘어갈 텐데 한번 고민해 보시기 바랍니다. 오케이, okay, let's move to the optimization part. So, question so far? 질문 있나요? 질문 있으신 분? 한번 봅시다. 우리가 이제 우리가 처음 시작할 때 117명으로 시작했던 것 같은데 이제 많이 줄었어요. 그렇죠? 76명 많이 남았어요. 많이 줄었어. 사실 반절 조금 넘게 남았죠? 여기까지 오신 분들 너무너무 수고하셨어요. 거의 다 왔고 이제 오늘 챕터가 끝나면 이제 조금 어플리케이션으로 넘어가면은 컴퓨터 비전 관련된 테크닉들을 좀 설명을 드릴 텐데 정말 거기서 조금 쉬운 얘기들을 할 거예요. 그냥 제너럴하게 컴퓨터 비전에서 어떤 일이 일어나고 있는지를 본다는 측면이면 될 것 같아요. 그래서 여기까지 빠짐없이 와주신 분들 너무 고맙고 정말 잘하고 있어요. 그래서 우리 이제 이 밖에 몇 강 안 남았잖아요. 그렇죠? 우리 이제 볼 수 있는 시간이 한 5번 될 것 같은데 6번 되나? 정말 마지막까지 따라오시면 뭔가 얻어가는 게 있을 거라 확신합니다. 그리고 또 한 가지 말씀드리고 싶은 게 우리 중간고사 없었어요. 그렇죠? 이제 기말고사 있을 거고 저번 학기 제 수업 들으신 분들 알겠지만 어려울 거예요. 그렇죠? 기말고사 정말 어려울 거고 공부 안 하고 있다 기말고사 때 하려면 정말 못 풀 거예요. 하나도 못 풀 거고 그렇기 때문에 꼭 우리 벌써 9강 넘어왔잖아요. 꼭 기말고사 되기 전에 이제 중간고사 끝났으니까 기말고사 되기 전에 좀 공부를 해놓기를 바랍니다. 알겠죠? 오케이. So, let's move to the optimization part. So, let's recap. Mini-batch SGDM optimization. What's that? For n epoch, I mean for n iteration, we sample the batch, I mean the set of the small set of the input data, which was called the batch things, right? So define looks like this, and we compute. We update the local. We update our parameter W with the learning rate and the local gradient. Not local gradient, loss gradient. Right. So to summarize, there are four steps. The first one is to sample the batch of data. The second one is the forward propagation it through the graph word network and get loss function. And backpropagate to calculate the gradient, backpropagate to calculate gradient, and update parameter using the gradient, update parameter using the gradient. Here. This is the general step in mini-batch SGD, or the mini-batch stochastic gradient descent, or the just called the stochastic gradient descent, or just called the SGD, but we have to remember that in deep learning area, SGD means we have to consider the batch concept or mini batch concept. Okay? So
So this was the mini batch SGD optimization. Let's think about the limitation of this SGD or the vanilla mini batch SGD optimization. Okay. 아, 질문 있었네요. 제 질문 한번 보고 갑시다. 6페이지 구하는 걸 그래디언트 하는 걸 한번 설명해 주세요. 자, 가봅시다. 자, 그쵸. 여기서 좀 빨리 넘어갔어요. 무슨 얘기냐면은 한국말로 설명 한번 할게요. 자, 5페이지에서 요 케이스는 요 벡터 하나, 요 점에서의 벡터 하나를 계산하기 위한 컴퓨테이션들을 정리했던 거죠. 그쵸? 근데 이제 우리가 X 프라임, 그러니까 X 프라임의 경우는 얘네들이 인디펜던트하게 정리가 되니까, 인디펜던트하게 계산이 되니까 그냥 이거를 이 각각의 점에서 계산됐던 계산들을 그냥 단순히 X 프라임 크기만큼, 즉 말은 스페셜 도메인만큼 그냥 계산해 주면 돼요. 그러니까 각각 인디펜던트하게 계산이 들어가는 거죠. 근데 이제 W와 바이어스 같은 경우는 사실 모든 스페셜 레졸 스페셜 도메인에서 쉐어드 되게 움직이는 거죠. 얘를 계산할 때 들어가는 커널과 얘를 계산할 들어가는 커널과 얘를 계산하는 커널들이 모두 똑같아요. 그렇죠? 그렇기 때문에 무슨 얘기냐? 요걸 계산할 때 우리가 그러니까 요 과정에서 우리가 알아낸 로스 그레디언트와 요 과정에서 우리가 알아낸 로스 그레디언트, 요 과정에서 알아낸 로스 그레디언트들이 이 전체 이 세 가지의 커널을 업데이트 하는데 이 세 가지가 모두 쓰여야 되는 거죠. 그렇죠? 왜냐? 얘네 세 가지의 아웃풋을 내기 위해서 동일한 커널이 쓰였기 때문인 거죠. 그렇기 때문에 이 한 개의 샘플, 한 개의 뉴런을 생각했을 때와 비교해서 이 스페셜 레졸루션, 그러니까 스페셜 축으로 XY 축으로 어그리게이션, 즉 서메이션이 일어나야 된다는 거죠. 그 로스 그레디언트가. 그렇기 때문에 얘네들 이 P축, P가 1부터 3025까지를 쭉 서메이션을 하면 어떤 형태가 나오냐면 이 형태가 나오고 바이오스를 쭉 형태로 서메이션 하면 또 어그리게이션 하면 이 형태로 표현이 될 거예요. 그렇기 때문에 제가 이렇게 표현을 한 거예요. 자, 다시 얘기하면은 얘를 우리가 P에 대해서 서메이션으로 써서 다시 이걸 벡터 매트릭스 폼으로 바꾸면은 이렇게 나올 거예요. 이렇게 이거는 한번 해보세요. 상효 박쌤. 그리고 성현 학생 김혜영 선수 오프라인. 아마 오프라인을 볼 확률이 매우 높아요. 오프라인으로 지금처럼 가면 오프라인으로 볼 건데 한번 또 상황이 봐야겠죠. 우리 뭐 코로나 또 심해지면 못 볼 수는 있는데 현재 상황에서 오프라인으로 볼 거예요. 오케이. So let's think about the problem of SGD. So let's think about the two variable case, W1 and W2 case. What if the loss changes quickly in one direction, but slowly in another direction? What does gradient descent do? So, let's think about this point. This case, local gradient. Maybe it looks like this one, but in this case, the loss change quickly in the W2 axis, but slowly changes. It slowly changes in W1 axis. So it could be moved to something like this one, but here it could be moved to this kind of things, right? Because the local gradient, it's going to be loss gradient at this point, it's going to look like this one, right? So if we directly use the SGD or the mini batch SGD, it could be very slow progress along the shallow dimension, so jitter along the steepest direction looks like this one. It could be unstable. So it is really hard to converge the global optimum. So it is the first problem of the SGD.
Another problem happens in the local minima or the saddle point.
As you already know, our loss function
it's not going to be the convex shape. It's going to be the very, I'd say, very noisy cases.
Looks like this one, or looks like this one. So in this case, there are so many local minimum. This one. So if you remember the original SGD here, it is only related to the loss gradient with respect to W itself. So if the loss gradient with respect to W is zero, I mean the zero gradient, something like the local minima case or the saddle point case, right? Do you know what the saddle point means? Looks like this one. The saddle point means the, how to say, the cost curve or the cost, it's going to be the contour plot, right? The contour plot. So, when we consider the W1, this loss function is going to be the convex optimization, concave case, concave. But when we consider the W2, it's going to be the convex case. So, here, it's called the saddle point. So, in two kinds of case, the loss gradient is going to be zero, right? So gradient distance gets stuck in this kind of the local minima or the saddle point. So it's going to be the probabilistic. So this kind of the saddle point, much more common in high dimensional case. So as you know, the deep convolutional neural network or the deep neural network are really, really high dimensional case. So their frequently happen the center point across our runnable parameter space. Okay, so this is the second problem of the SGD. So our gradient come from the mini batch, as you know, right? So they can be really noisy, right? So, SGD was defined to practice. SGD need a pool sum. Because the pool sum is too expensive, they use the small number. They extract the small number of data. So it's called the mini batch. Examples of 32, 64, 128, something like this. So, could be very noisy. So this is the loss function, and this is the gradient of loss function with respect to W. From now on, we can write the loss gradient. Looks like this one, right? It's going to be defined looks like this. It's very, let's say, common loss function with a regularizing term. So in this case, when we start from here, our optimization path move looks like this. It's going to be really noisy. We have to convert to here, but our optimization path is going to be really noisy and it's going to be really slow. So it's going to be another problem of SGD. Right. Even though this loss function is convex one, right? So this loss function is convex. Oh. 이거 이제 무슨 얘기냐면 이런 식으로 그려져. 사실 이거는 보면 쉬운데도 이렇게 쉬운 로컬 그레디언트, 글로벌 그레디언트가 결정이 남에도 불구하고 이런 우리가 SGD를 사용한 기존의 그냥 바닐라 SGD를 쓰면 다음과 같이 노이즈하게 횟수를 따라갈 수밖에 없다. 라는 게 한계점들이고, 우리가 벌써 처음에 우리가 SGD, 그레디언트 디센트를 얘기할 때부터 이제 얘기를 했던 문제가 되겠습니다. Okay. How can we address these kinds of the issues? How can we address the upper mentioned issues? To overcome these, numerous methods or the fancier optimization technique have been proposed. For example, like the SGD plus momentum, Nesterov momentum, or the ADA gradient, or the RMS propagation, or the ADAM, or the BGFS, something like this. So today we will talk about some of them. I mean, some of the fancier optimization to overcome aforementioned problem. Okay. Okay. So people keep moving. Let's take a. Okay. Yeah. Let's take a 10-minute break.
Okay, so let's continue. 이게 저희가 한 시간이 지나고 나면은 좀 에러가 생기는 것 같기도 한데 혹시 저번 시간에 그랬잖아요. 우리 한번 오늘도 해보다가 조금 에러가 한번 껐다 켜봤는데 혹시 에러가 생기면은 알려줘요 저한테. Okay, let's start. So when you think about the SGD update rule, WT plus one, T means the one it, I mean the iteration index. So T plus one is the updated parameter W. Previous WT could be added with the negative alpha times the loss, alpha times gradient FWT. So let me say this is a loss function, but just consider this is just a arbitrary vector, arbitrary function f, right? Loss, but yeah, just gradient. Of course, this is the new one and previous one. So in this case, we can draw the loss function. This one, f, w, parameter w, and this point, let me say wt, it will be moved to the this direction, right? So this is the Stochastic gradient descent. Okay, so this is stochastic gradient descent. Here's the insight, because as you know, the stochastic gradient descent has some previous limitation, so we want to address those kinds of limitation. So here was insight. So delta F is going to be the gradient of the potential energy. Okay, from now on, let's think about let's assume this F is the potential energy defined looks like this one at the left hand side. Then let's go back to the physics things. Okay. Here. So there's a rule to find out the minimum point. The pulse here, let me say this is pulse, is the negative gradient of potential energy. In other words, if we just assume that our loss function or just the F function is the potential energy, then the pulse at this point, I mean the WT point, it's going to be the negative gradient of the pulse potential energy. So it's going to be looks like this, right? 자, 무슨 말이 이게 무슨 말이냐면은, 자 이제 우리가 옵티마이즈 하는 게 뭐냐고 했냐면은 어떠한 등고선 또는 어떠한 loss function을 따라서 W에서 시작해서 쭉 따라 내려가서 밑으로 내려가는 거죠. 그래서 이제 우리가 이거를 현실에서 생각해 보면은 어떤 physics world, 그러니까 우리가 어떤 물리적 공간을 생각을 해보면 어떤 얘가 공을 올렸다 쳤을 때 이 공이 이렇게 저 위치 에너지에 따라서 이렇게 내려가는 경우라고 보시면 돼요. 자, 우리가 어떠한 뭐라고 하면 산에다가 공을 이렇게 올려놓으면 공이 이렇게 밑으로 내려가잖아요. 왜 내려가겠어요? 이렇게 경사 쪽으로 얘가 힘을 받기 때문에 내려가는 거죠. 그렇죠. 자, 이 모멘텀이란 얘기를 이제 하려고 그러는데 이게 무슨 얘기냐면은 이제 요 옵티멈으로 찾아가는 과정, 미니멈으로 찾아가는 과정을 사실 공이 굴러가는 어떤 피직스에서 어떤 물체가 힘을 받는 걸로 생각을 해보자 이거죠. 그랬을 때 저 F라는 펑션, 즉 로스라는 펑션은 어떤 포텐셜 에너지, 즉 쉽게 생각하면 위치 에너지라고 볼 수 있는 거고 어떤 포텐셜 에너지라고 볼 수 있고 이때 저 지점에서의 받는 물체의 힘 이 사실 네거티브 그래디언트 오브 포텐셜 에너지
라고 볼 수가 있는 거죠. 이거 한번 찾아봐요. 이해가 안 되시는 분들은. 그래서 무슨 얘기를 하고 싶은 거냐면, So, let's think about the Newton's method, Newton's rule. So, the force is equal to ma죠? F and ma. So, 이게 mass죠? Mass times acceleration. Acceleration, right? F and ma죠? 그쵸? 그래서 이제 무슨 얘기를 하고 싶은 거냐면, So, okay. Let's think about our delta f. In this case, in this kind of the interpretation, delta f can be seen as a acceleration. Acceleration. 가속도죠, 그러니까. 무슨 얘기냐면, 한국말로 가속도고, 무슨 얘기냐면, 이제 우리가 어떤 물체가 밑으로 떨어지는 거는 사실 어떤 힘을 받아서였고 그 힘이라는 거는 포텐셜 에너지의 네가티브 그레디언트로 표현될 수가 있는데 그때 이제 그 힘이라는 거는 사실 어떤 질량의 acceleration, 가속도가 곱해진 형태이다. 자, 복잡하게 설명했는데 그냥 어쨌든 뭐냐. 이 델타 F는 사실 가속도와 연관이 되어 있었다라고 우리가 생각을 해볼 수가 있는 거죠. 그렇죠? 지금 WT가 이제 어떤 포지션 오브 포텐셜 에너지였으니까 이제 여기라는 WT라는 점이었으니까 자 어렵게 설명을 했는데 결국 이거예요. 그래서 So in SD plus momentum technique, we'd like to introduce the concept of velocity. Concept of velocity. This case, negative gradient of f or negative gradient of loss function is going to be the velocity times the arbitrary number, arbitrary value alpha, right? We can rewrite this one, right? Because these two terms should be same. Accelerator is related to the gradient of the loss function, so it can be represent, it can be explained in terms of the velocity term. So we can rewrite this velocity. Velocity t plus 1 is going to be the velocity, the current velocity minus alpha times loss gradient. Loss gradient. Right? 이거 오타가 있네요. 여기요. W. So in general, in a more general form, we can rewrite velocity of the t plus 1 is going to be the rho times vt, velocity of the current point, minus alpha times gradient of w. Gradient of w. Right. From now on, let's use this term to derive the new optimization, new update rule in SGD. So, here's the difference. Our original update rule, Wt plus 1 is equal to Wt minus alpha times delta F of Wt. SGD plus momentum defined looks like this. Velocity T plus 1 is equal to rho times velocity T minus alpha times delta F of Wt. And from here, right? And new update parameter WT plus 1 is going to be WT plus VWT plus 1. VWT plus 1. So, what does it mean? In original SGD, they just considered the gradient to update our parameter W, but in SGD plus momentum K, not only consider gradient, but also consider the velocity term, in this case, V, to derive the actual update step, defined like this. So, in other words, in SGD plus momentum, we can build the velocity as a learning mean of the gradient, right? 무슨 얘기냐면, 이게 이제는 관성이랑 똑같은 얘기인데, 우리가 이제 어떠한 산을 내려오든 로스 펑션을 따라 내려올 때 우리는 어쨌든 과속도라는 개념을 도입을 한다면 내가 현재에서 받는 힘도 중요 현재에서 받는 힘이 중요한데 현재에서 구해지는 그레디언트가 사실 어떤 가속도, 즉 내가 이전까지 계산되어 왔던 나의 속도와 연관이 됐었던 거죠. 그렇죠? 그렇기 때문에 내가 현재 포인트에서 그레디언트의 어떤 로스 그레디언트가 에러인 경우라도 이전까지 계산해왔던 로스 그레디언트들이 어떤 하나의 위치를 따라 잘 내려왔다면 어떤 로컬 미니마 같은 곳에서도 우리가 쉽게 빠져나갈 수가 있겠죠? 근데 이게 모멘텀이라는 개념을 사용해서 SGD를 임프로브한 버전의 가장 큰 핵심 개념이라고 생각하시면 될것 같아요. So, in this case, rho, this parameter, gives a flexion. 이게 뭐죠? 이게 한국말로 하면 마찰? 마찰이죠. 그래서 마찰 개념을 도입한 거죠. 조금 더 뭐랄까 모멘텀이라는 걸 사용할 때 조금 더 천천히 벨로시티가 업데이트가 되게 하기 위함인 거예요. 그래서 typically the rho is going to be the 0.9 or the 0.99, right? So this is the SGD plus momentum. Okay. So SGD plus momentum works better than SGD, I mean the original SGD, by addressing the following issues to some extent. For example, like the local minimum or the saddle point, right? Okay. And full conditioning. Full conditioning was the limitation of these kinds of things. Right? So here's the example. If we start from the same point, same initial point, SGD move like this, but SGD point momentum could be looks like this. So if follow more smoothly bearing optimization path comparing to the SGD technique, thanks to momentum term, something like this one. Okay, so this is the SGD plus momentum. One more thing is the Nestor law of momentum technique. So comparing to SGD plus momentum defined with the velocity term. So velocity was defined with the rho vt minus alpha times delta f. And t plus 1, it was wt plus velocity, t plus 1. So actual step of actual step for the update of the WT was here. So it combined gradient at the current point, combined the gradient at the current point with the velocity to get step used to update way. So current point gradient and the current point velocity. It was the original SGD plus momentum, but in Nestor law of momentum, difference are here. Rather than using the gradient and the current point, gradient at the current point, they try to use the gradient at the after point. Here. In other words, it look ahead to the point where updating using velocity would take us. In this case here, at this point, they compute the gradient like this one, and our actual update step, it's going to be the velocity plus gradient, so it's going to look like this. So in other words, the Nestor momentum case
We'd like to look ahead for the point where update using the velocity would take us. So in this case, compute the gradient there and mix it with the velocity to get actual update direction.
무슨 얘기냐면 이 케이스는 이제 그레디언트를 계산할 때 단순 현재 포인트에서 계산하는 게 아니라 우리가 벨로시티만큼을 움직였다고 가정을 했을 때 점에서의 그레디언트를 계산함으로써 어떤 우리가 관성에 따라 내려오는 특성을 좀더잘 가져오고 싶음인 거고, 그랬을 때 어떤 현재 포인트에 로컬 미니멈에 빠질 확률이 있었다면 이렇게 그레디언트를 요 벨로시티만큼 움직인 곳에서 계산함으로써 로컬 미니멈 또는 새들 포인트 에 빠질 확률을 최소화시키고자 하는 거죠. So, natural momentum defined like this. So here's the difference. I mean, here's the comparison. So, 그래서 이렇게 되는 거죠. 그래서 original SGD act like this. SGD product momentum looks like this one. Might be a thing. Move to this part, but natural momentum act looks like this. So it's much faster convergence than SGD or the SGD plus momentum. Okay. So of course there are so many other variants, like the ADA gradient or the RMS probe or the ADAM or the FG FS and LFGS. In this course, we cannot deal with such a kind of the technique. So I would like to suggest you study this kind of thing yourself if you are interested in the optimization technique to improve your neural network. Okay. So today we are also interested in the improving the testing error. We would like to be on the training error. So here's the training loss graph. So in this case, the better optimization algorithm help reduce the training loss. So as we discussed here, better optimization algorithm help reduce the training loss. Looks like this one. But when in considering the validation set or the testing set, there might be the performance gap. There might be the performance gap as you're evolving the epoch or the iteration. So we really care about the error on the new data. Test data. So the question is, how to reduce this kind of gap? How to reduce this kind of the training accuracy and validation accuracy, or training accuracy and validation accuracy? This is our goal in training the neural network. 자, 이 얘기도 우리가 다 했었던 거예요. 그쵸? 우리 지금 이제 저번 시간부터 이번 시간 오면서 많은 이제 하이 테크놀로지 테크닉들을 배우고 있지만, 사실 우리가 이런 테스팅 에러를 줄여야 되는 문제를 우리는 뭐 벌써 3강에서부터 얘기를 했었죠. 그래서 어떤 머신러닝 문제에서 발생할 수 있는 바이어스 앤 베리언스 프라블럼 or 오버피팅 앤 언더피팅 프라블럼이라는 것 때문에 테스팅 에러와, 그러니까 트레이닝 에러와 테스팅 에러가 다를 수밖에 없는 문제가 빈번하게 발생을 했던 거고, 어떻게 테스팅 에러를 맥시마이즈 할 수 있을까? 그러니까 사실 우리의 최종 목적인 거죠. 그래서 This time, let's think about how to improve the test error, right? Okay. Very simple technique. It's always stopping. Actually, we have to always do. So, always stopping meaning, if you think about the loss gradient with respect to the iteration or the epoch, it could be looks like this, right? What about accuracy? When we think about the accuracy of the training evaluation, training accuracy increase looks like this one, but validation accuracy would be reduced after some point. So we already know this is this kind of phenomena due to the overfitting problem, right? Overfitting problem. So stop training the model when accuracy of validation set decreases, or train for long time but always keep track of the model snapshot. Model snapshot means the model parameter at each iteration, then work the best on the validation set. Then just choose this one. This is very simple technique to improve the testing error.
어렵지 않아요? 이거는 뭐냐면 그냥 여러 가지 방법이 있는데 우리가 로스 그래프를 보다가 밸러데이션 셋이 증가하면 끄거나 아니면 이거를 이터레이션만 저장해놓고 가장 좋은 거 쓰면 되는 거죠? 가장 간단한 방법이 그렇죠? 하지만 사실 너무 약하죠. 그렇죠?
So we have to think about another technique.
Next technique is the model ensemble. So here is the procedure.
First of all, we train the multiple independent model.
Multiple independent model.
At test time, just average their result. Specifically, take average of predicted probability distribution, then choose the argument.
So this is the model ensemble technique. Generally, we can enjoy the 2-point extra performance with the model ensemble technique. 많이 쓰는 방법이죠. 그냥 모델을 하나 학습하는 게 아니라 여러 개의 모델을 뭐 다른 이니셜라이제이션으로 시작을 해서 인디펜던트하게 학습을 하면 당연히 다른 결과들로 떨어질 거고 테스트 타임에서는 그러한 결과들 에버리지를 통해서 모델의 성능을 높이는 아주 간단한 방법이겠죠? So with this such a kind of model ensemble technique, we can get the 2-point extra performance. But here's another technique, similar to the model ensemble, but other technique. Instead of training independent model, because training independent model could be really expensive, right? Use multiple snapshots of the single model during the training. Single training. What does it mean? Here's the example. In left-hand side, this is the original optimization path with the standard error schedule. But in this case, they tried to train this one single network with a cyclic learning rate and model ensemble with this cyclic learning rate.
Okay, let me show you the example. Here.
뭐 외울 필요 없고 그냥 신기한 재밌는 논문인 것 같아서 한번 가져와 본 거예요. 그래서 뭐냐면
So
the blue line is just standard error scheduling. I mean the learning rate scheduling. Right? Just something like this one. Something like this. But in this paper, they try to use the cyclic learning rate schedule. Looks like this one, and this one. Right? So by using such kinds of the cyclic learning rate scheduling,
the model undergoes several learning rate annealing cycles and converging to an escape from multiple local minima.
Multiple local minima.
Something like this one, this one, this one. Then we might have the multiple parameter. Multiple parameter. And then just take a snapshot at each minimum, in this case, 1, 2, 3, three kinds of things for test time ensemble. So this snapshot ensemble technique to improve the testing error. Let me explain this model in Korean again. 자, 이건 그냥 뭐 다양히 엄청나게 많은 방법들이 있을 거예요. 그냥 엄청나게 많은 모델 앙상블 할 수 있는 방법이 있을 텐데 그냥 좀 간단해 보이는 거 하나를 가져와 봤어요. 뭐냐면은 기존에 이제 러닝 리드 스케줄링 저번 시간에 배웠던 것처럼 한번 볼까요? 러닝 리드 스케줄링 하는 거 얘기했었죠? 많이 쓰는 방법들이 있어요. 그래서 뭐 러닝 리드 이런 식으로 에폭 정해진 에폭마다 줄인다든지 뭐 이렇게 리니어하게 줄인다든지 이렇게 인버스 케어루트로 정한다든지 러닝 레이트를 트레이닝 과정, 즉 에폭 과정에서 조절해주는 게 매우 중요하다고 얘기를 했었고 그렇기 때문에 기존의 러닝 레이트 줄이는 방법이 이제 파란색이라고 썼을 때 이렇게 어떤 에폭마다 이렇게 줄여드는 형태가 있었다고 썼을 때 우리는 모델 앙상블을 통해서 어떠한 improvement, 테스트 에러의 improvement를 얻고 싶은 건데 테스트 퍼포먼스 improvement을 얻고 싶은데 모델 앙상블을 위해서 하나의 네트워크, 하나의 모델을 여러 번 학습한다는 게 정말 어려운 문제죠. 그러니까 정말 타임 컨슈밍 하는 거죠. 아까 얘기했지만 뭐 2%, 3% 올리기 위해서 정말로 수많은 뭐 저희 알겠지만 딥러닝 쪽에서 이제 연구를 하는 친구들은 알겠지만 하나 돌리는 데 엄청 오래 걸리잖아요. 뭐 하루 큰 것들은 며칠씩 걸리는데 이 모델 앙상블 하나를 위해서 그 큰 모델을 여러 번 학습한다는 건 정말 비효율적인 거죠. 그래서 이 페이퍼에서 무슨 얘기를 하는 거냐면은 이 러닝 레이트 스케줄을 이런 식으로 급격하게 줄이고 이걸 다시 한번 사이클로 올려서 다시 한번 줄이고 또 러닝 레이트 올려서 다시 한번 줄이고를 반복해 보는 거예요. 그럼 어쨌든 러닝 레이트를 이렇게 급격하게 줄이다 보면 급격하게 올렸다가 줄이다 보면 이 모델 1은 어떠한 로컬 미니마에서 빠지고 끝날 거예요. 그렇죠? 그리고 이 모델 2 이제 여기서부터 학습되는 모델 2 그러니까 같은 모델인데 이 모델 1에서 까지 학생 파라미터가 있을 거고 그걸 저장해 놓는 거고 거기서부터 다시 한번 이 러닝 레이트에 따라서 학습되는 파라미터가 이제 모델 2라고 하면 쭉쭉쭉 모델들이 저장될 수 있을 거겠죠. 그때 저장되는 모델들은 생각을 해보면 이런 각각의 로컬 미니마에 빠졌던 모델들일 거예요. 물론 로컬 미니마인지 글로벌 미니마인지 알 수 없지만 어떤 형태로든지 미니마에 빠졌던 애들이 저장이 될 거고 그럼 우리가 한 번의 트레이닝 과정에서 이러한 멀티플 파라미터, 즉 여기서 보면은 모델 1, 2, 3, 뭐 6개 물론 이제 뒤에 몇 개만 쓰긴 하는데 몇 개의 모델들, 그러니까 몇 개의 로컬 미니마를 가지는 모델들만 그냥 파라미터 저장해놨다가 그걸 테스팅 타임에서 앙상블로 쓸 수 있으면 우리가 이렇게 인디펜던트하게 모델들을 트레이닝 학습하지 않아도 실제 앙상블 효과를 줄 수 있다라는 게 이 논문의 컨트리뷰션이었고 혹시 조금 더 구체적으로 보고 싶은 분들은 스냅샷 앙상블이라는 페이퍼를 보시면 될 것 같아요. 물론 이거 말고도 정말 많은 이 앙상블 테크닉들이 있는데 네, 일단 이 논문만 대표적으로 소개를 했습니다. 됐죠? 꼭 에포를 기준으로 스케줄링을 해야 하나요? 아니면 데이터가 많은 경우 이터레이션으로 기준 스케일링에도 관계없는 건가요? 자, 영준 쌤, 에포이랑 이터레이션이 뭐가 다르죠? 어떻게 달라요? 그렇죠. 그 어떻게 관계가 있죠? 에폭과 이터레이션 어떻게 관계가 있죠? 서브셋. 그렇죠. 그러면은 조금 더 들어가서 에폭 한 번이 이터레이션 몇 번이라 결정 몇 번으로 에폭 한 번이 결정되는 거를 뭐의 결정 다시 에폭 한 번은 이터레이션 개수와 어떻게 연관이 되어 있죠? 그러면 서브셋 맞죠? 당연히 서브셋이고 어떻게 연관돼요? 배치 사이즈와 연관이 되죠? 그렇죠? 결국은 뭐냐? 우리가 배치 사이즈를 고정해 놓고 에폭을 돌린다고 치면 이터레이션은 리니어하게 에폭 사이즈와 영향을 받을 거예요. 그렇죠? 그 리니어다라고 하는 거는 넘버 오브 배치와 연관이 될 거고 그렇기 때문에 에폭을 기준으로 스케줄링을 하는 거와 이터레이션, 즉 어떤 이터레이션 기준에서 어떤 동일한 위치에서 이터레이션, 그러니까 동일한 스텝 다시요 여기를 축을 이터레이션이라고 봤을 때도 여기가 이터레이션이라고 써져도 사실 우리가 동일한 스텝 사이즈를 놓고 생각을 하면은 사실 똑같은 모델이 나올 거예요. 그렇죠? 그렇기 때문에 결론적으로는 epoch이나 이터레이션으로 어떤 걸 기준으로 해도 상관은 없다라고 말씀드리는 게 맞는 것 같아요. 답변이 됐나요? 네. So, other question so far? 오늘 몇 장 남았죠? 이거 오늘 끝내야 되는데? 아, 거의 다 왔네. 자, 봅시다. So, from now on, let's think about the regularization technique. So far we discussed the ensemble technique, but the question is how to improve the single model performance, not a multiple model, the single model performance. This problem, right? This problem was the overfitting problem or just called the, what's that? Variance problem, right? Variance problem. How can we solve this? Regularization, right? We already talked about this regularization technique several times, right? Let's just recap. So, what's the regularization? There are so many techniques to regularize our network parameter. So, when you think about this kind of the loss function, very simple case and the very basic case is L2 regularization or the error regularization defined looks like this one. Practice. 이게 다 했던 거죠? 스퀘어 썸이나 앱솔루트 썸을 단순히 로스 펑션만 더해줘도 우리가 모델을 심플로하게 만들 수 있다. 즉 2장, 3장이었죠? 우리가 오캄스 룰을 얘기하면서 얘기를 했어요. 그래서 우리의 모델을 더 심플러 better, right? So 우리가 모델을 더 심플하게 만들고 싶었을 때 이제 우리가 regularization 테크닉들이 들어갔었고 에런 L2 등이 들어갔습니다. 뭐 그때 얘기는 안 했지만 이 두 개를 섞어서 하는 방법도 있어요. So elastic net technique was the eron plus L2. So this regularizer defined looks like this. L2 plus L1. There's another one, maximum regularization technique, looks like this one, but yeah, internal technique. And there are so many other variants of the dropout, drop connection, fractal map filling, fractionalization, stochastic, depth, and data augmentation things. Actually, this kind of regularization was studied at the machine learning area before the 2020, but this kind of regularization technique very recently published and very recently developed to stabilize the deep learning stabilization. Right? 무슨 얘기했냐면은 뭐 드랍아웃부터 해서 이제 오늘 배울 것들을 좀 얘기할 건데 이러한 레귤러 테크닉들은 정말 최근에 이제 발견이 된 것들이죠. 그렇죠? 그래서 드랍아웃 페이퍼, 드랍아웃 같은 경우는 알렉스네 2012년도에 처음 페이퍼. 맞나? 맞아요. 맞을 거예요. 네, 드랍아웃 처음이랑 개념을 썼었고 뭐 이제 패턴 모델라이제이션이라는 것도 2015년도에 ICML이라는 페이퍼에서 첫 번째 나온 개념이고 불과 몇 년 전이죠? 5년 전 나왔던 거 데이터 어그멘테이션 이런 테크닉들은 사실 조금 더 딥러닝을 스테이블하게 학습하기 위해서 썼던 레귤라이제이션이라고 설명한 게 맞는 것 같아요. 물론 이런 레귤라이제이션은 전통적인 머신러닝에서 많이 썼던 방법들이고요. 그렇죠? So today, let's think about the advanced technique to stabilize our deep learning training. Okay, so main philosophy of the regularization is something like this. So main philosophy of the regularization in deep learning area is the randomness. Randomness. What does it mean? In training pay, we'd like to add some kind of randomness. Let's think about this equation. X is the input signal, for example, like image, and output is the label. Output is the just output, for example, like label. In case of the image generation, Y is going to be the image as well, but let's think about just the label. Label means just like image classification case, right?
F means our mapping function, right? Our mapping function, right? So, in modern regularization technique, based on the randomness, they try to add some kinds of the random variable in our mapping function.
And then they would like to
average out the randomness in testing phase, sometimes approximate.
So
our improved output y is going to be the f of x, and it's going to be the ensemble of the f of x comma z across the z domain.
So it's going to be the integral, right? So batch normalization is the one of these kinds of technique, right? Why?
In training phase, batch normalization normalized using the statistics from the random mini batch. Right?
Random mini batch.
And in testing phase, they just use the fixed statistic to normalize. Right? So let's go back to the batch normalization. So, like this. So, they compute the Poisson mean and Poisson variance across the random subsample. I mean the random mini batch, and then use this kind of randomness to improve the testing error at testing accuracy, right? So they just use the learning average of the values seen during training, right? So this is one of the example, but generally the main design philosophy of the modern regularization are based on the randomness. Okay, so from now on, let's think about the very successful modern regularization technique. Okay. So first one is the Drawbar. First one, Drawbar. You already know, right? So Drawbar is widely used to avoid the overfitting issue during training. How? In each port path, okay. Input, output, right? So it's going to be the port propagation, right? In each port path, randomly set some neuron to zero. So we can remove the some neuron during training. The priority of the dropping is just the hyperparameter, but 0.5 is common. So this is the concept of dropout. So by randomly eliminating some neuron, they just gave a randomness to our neural network. So finally, they can improve the testing accuracy. So how can this possibly be a good idea? So here is the intuitive example. This dropout forces the network to have a redundant representation. And prevent co-adaptation of features. So here's the example. Let me say this is a node, each node, something like blah 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 things. Let's assume that this node contains the information of the ear, or the has a tail, or the furry, or the claw, or the what is that? I don't know exactly, but anyway, these kinds of features can be contributed to cat classification, right? So by randomly erasing the some neuron, we can impulse this kind of neuron to contribute the cat classification, right?
So by randomly erasing the neuron during the each train iteration, we can increase the representation power of the, our neural network or the convolutional neural network. So this is the dropout technique. Another interpretation of the dropout is that dropout is the training large ensemble of the model that share the parameter. Each binary mask is one model. 뭐야? 이게 앞에서 얘기했던 앙상블이랑 비슷한 거죠? 우리가 랜덤하게 뉴럴들을 지운다라는 거는 다른 여러 개의 모델을 학습하는 거와 똑같은 효과가 있다라고 생각할 수가 있는 거고, 그때 그냥 단순한 모델 앙상블과의 차이점은 걔네들은 shared parameter, 어떠한 샘플들은 shared parameter를 가지고 있다라는 측면인 거죠. 무슨 얘기냐면은 뭐 언제는 얘를 지웠다가 뭐 두 번째 이터레이션에서는 둘 다 남겨놨다가 뭐 얘만 달렸다가 이런 식으로 여러 개의 모델을 학습했다고도 할 수 있는 거예요. 그렇죠? So we can understand that this dropout as a large ensemble of the model that shared the parameter. So for example, for an FC layer case with 4096 unit has the 2 to the 4096 possible mask. So it's going to be impossible to search the every possible mask. So by using the dropout case, we can improve the testing error, a testing accuracy. So let me explain this part in a randomness philosophy. During training, dropout make a output random, right? With a random mask. And then we want to average out the randomness at the test time from the perspective of the model ensemble. Looks like this one. Average across the jet, like this. But as I told you here, it's not possible to compute this integral because this integral seems too hard. Right? So in this case, we want to approximate the integral as a power. So let's consider single neural case. Input x, input y, and w1 is the parameter, one parameter, w2 is another parameter, and a is output. Then at test time, the original output is going to be the y is equal to w1 times x1 plus w2 times x2. When the dropout is used with the probability p is equal to 0.5, we have y is equal to fx, it's going to be the average across the jet here. Okay? And we can rewrite these kinds of things, like this, and this. So it's going to be 1 over 2. Times W1 X1 plus X2 W2. 0.5. So, 무슨 얘기냐면, 자, 얘가 드랍이 되고 안 되고, 각자 2분의 1 확률이면, 얘네들이 나올 수 있는 모든 경우의 수는, 자, 2분의 1 곱하기, 두 가지 경우니까 네 가지 케이스가 있잖아요. 그래서 네 가지 케이스가 이런 식으로 나올 수 있고, 얘네들 다 서메이션 하면, 원래 오리지널 아웃풋에다가 우리가 계산했던 프로버티가 곱한 형태가 될 거예요. 그렇죠? 그래서 이게 가장 간단한 샘플 이그램플이었는데 사실 뉴런들이 많아지면 이 가정이 깨지긴 하겠지만 여기서 어프로시메이션을 그냥 하는 거죠. 그래서 at test time just multiply original output by dropout probability to compute the average. This is an approximated ensemble technique to improve the test accuracy. So this was the dropout. Another technique, data augmentation, right? Data augmentation is very simple. We can randomly apply the mix or the combination of the following data augmentation. For example, like the geometric transformation, such as the horizontal flip, translation, rotation, stretching, shearing, and so on, or the lens distortion, or the random crop, or scaling or the color jittering, something like this. So from the original training data, we randomly transform the image with this kind of the technique and train our network. So during as evolving the iteration, we randomly sample the combination of the this kind of data augmentation. Then we can extend our input image manifold by using the this kind of data augmentation. So let me show you. Good job. So let me say we have a image manifold, training image manifold, something like this. Training sample. This was the real image manifold. With this kind of the subset, very small subset, we cannot train the such a underlying mapping function or the underlying real image manifold. But by applying the random noise on the image or data augmentation, we can extend this training image manifold something like this, training, extend training image manifold by augmentation. So this is the data augmentation. 무슨 얘기한 거냐면 데이터 augmentation 여러 가지 geometric transform, post-metric transform을 input 데이터에 입힘으로써 이제 데이터에 우리가 부족한 데이터 또는 어떤 편향된 데이터의 어떤 distribution을 늘려준 효과가 있다고 했는데 이제 이미지에 생각하면 무슨 얘기가 되냐면 어떤 real image manifold가 이렇게 파란색으로 구성이 되어 있을 때 우리가 가지고 있는 training sample은 이렇게 스파스하고 사실 어떤 편향된 데이터일 수밖에 없는 거예요. 그렇죠? 왜냐하면 리얼 이미지가 가질 수 있는 매니폴드 리얼 이미지가 가진 매니폴드는 사실 무한한 스페이스상에 존재할 거고 우리가 가질 수 있는 데이터 샘플은 제한적이기 때문인 거죠. 그렇기 때문에 어떻게 하면 조금 더 우리의 트레이닝 샘플의 매니폴드를 정말 리얼 이미지의 매니폴드 또는 리얼 이미지의 언더라인 펑션으로 어떻게 익스텐드를 할까라는 측면에서 이제 데이터 어그멘테이션이 아주 간단하면서도 쉽게 트레이닝 샘플의 매니폴드를 익스텐션 할 수 있는 테크닉이다 라고 이해하시면 될 것 같아요. So, I'd like to introduce a very interesting paper. This paper is called the Think Layer. This paper published at ICML this year. Maybe some of you already know this one. In this paper, Representation learning with contrastive loss, something like this. 컨트라스트 루스라는 게 있는데 이거는 일단은 여기서 넘어갑시다. 무슨 얘기냐면 So, in this paper, there are so many kinds of the data augmentation technique. In this paper, we have the original image, X. Then they apply the two different kinds of the augmentation things, right? And then they would like to maximize the agreement between the these two features. I mean, the two features from the different augmented images. Then by using these kinds of things with contrastive learning, we can train the network without supervision. 무슨 얘기냐면은 이제 기존에 지금까지 우리가 얘기했던 거는 다 어떤 클래스피케이션과 같은 슈퍼비전들이 있어서 어떤 우리가 네트워크를 학습한 얘기들만 했는데 이제 데이터 어그멘테이션이라는 게 얼마나 강력한지를 보여주는 이제 페이퍼예요. 그래서 데이터 똑같은 이미지만 있을 때 이게 뭐 강아지인든 뭐 고양이인든 알 수는 없지만 얘네 다른 두 가지 어그멘테이션을 먹여서 즉이 트레이닝 데이터에다 랜덤니스를 먹여서 얘네들이 이두 개의 강아지가 다른 어그멘테이션에 들어갔지만 얘네들이 항상 같은 피처 액티베이션 맵을 가져야 된다라는 어떤 컨스트레인을 콘트라스틱 로스라는 걸로 줌으로써 이 레프렌테이션, 이 H라는 레프렌테이션을 우리가 슈퍼비전 역시 학습할 수 있다라는 첫 번째 페이퍼는 하지만 많은 시도들이 있었지만 거의 이게 가능한 걸 비저 쪽에서 보여준 거의 첫 번째 페이퍼였어요. 그래서 조금 이제 역사적인 얘기로 들어가면 사실 어떤 NLP의 분야, NLP 분야 이제 하시는 친구들 여기 많이 있을 텐데 뭐 벌트나 뭐 크랜스 뭐 벌트가 대표적이죠. 벌트나 뭐 기타 그 다른 방법들은 보면 어쨌든 우리가 인풋 데이터만 가지고 학습 로스 시그널, 즉 슈퍼비전이 없이 어떤 셀프 슈퍼비전 태스크를 듣고 피처 레퍼런트 학습하는 게 매우 일반적으로 이제 와갔지만 사실 비전 쪽에서는 그러지 못했던 게 현실이에요. 왜냐하면 슈퍼바이즈드 학습 기법들이 너무 잘 됐었고 그 슈퍼비전들과 셀프 슈퍼바이즈드 기법들 사이에 어떤 성능의 갭이 사실 메꾸기 힘들었던 측면들이 많았어요. 근데 이제 요 싱클레어라는 페이퍼를 기점으로 사실 모코라는 페이퍼도 있고 수많은 페이퍼들 사실 이 페이퍼도 이제 엄청 옛날 페이퍼가 됐고 수많은 페이퍼들 이제 NLP 분야에서처럼 비전 쪽에서도 어떻게 셀프 슈퍼바이즈드로 즉 학습 시그널 없이 어떻게 레프렌테이션을 배울 수 있을까라는 걸 이제 고민을 하기 시작한 거죠. 그래서 비전을 공부하시는 친구들이 있다면은 요런 페이퍼들 재밌게 보시면 좋을 것 같아요. 아마 다른 시일 안에 이제 비전 쪽에서도 뭔가 이러한 유행이라고 그럴까요? 어떤 셀프 슈퍼비전을 통해서 레프렌테이션 학습하는 기법들이 아마 메인스트림으로 자리 잡을 거라고 저는 개인적으로 생각을 합니다. 오케이. 그래서 그 다른 분야에 있는 분들은 아마 어려울 수도 있어요. 그래서 제가 이 강의에서 하는 내용보다 조금 더 어려운 페이퍼들은 소개는 시켜주고 있는데 너무 걱정하지 마시고 그냥 제가 이렇게 간단히 소개시켜드리는 페이퍼는 뭐 관심 있는 친구들은 보면 되고 뭐 아닌 친구들은 아, 뭐 이런 일도 일어나고 있구나 라는 정도만 이해하면 될것 같아요. 오케이. One more technique is the deep drop connection. So, drop connection is similar to the drop out. In drop out, we drop the neuron, but in drop connection, we drop the weight. We drop the weight. So, we drop the weight, something like this, or something like this. So this is the drop connection. And another thing is the fractional pooling. Fractional pooling. So let's say we have a input feature. This is just a special resolution. It doesn't consider any channel dimension. Why? Because the pooling just happened across the special domain. So let's just considering the special resolution n in by n in and output sizes n out by n out. In max pooling, we just use the fixed size of the window to choose the representation value, right? This is just the original max pooling. But in fractional max pooling, they just consider the randomness. In this case, the random size of the window, for example, like this one, or this one, to compute the representation value during in pooling layer. This is called the fractional pooling. So they just perform the max pooling with a fraction of the n in over n out. This is performed stochastically or randomly. Okay. So this is a practical max pooling. 자, 오늘 좀 빨리 넘어가고 있는데 다 논문 레퍼 달아놨으니까 관심 있는 분들 다 논문 찾아서 읽어보면 돼요. 그렇죠? 우리는 큰 메인스트림만 배우자 이거죠. 자, 레귤라이제이션이라는 게 지금 이 페이퍼들 무슨 얘기를 하고 싶은 거냐? 우리의 모델에 어떤 방식으로 랜덤니스를 줘서 이 모델의 캐패시티, 즉이 모델이 가지고 있는 캐패시티를 맥시마이즈할 수 있을까? 그럼으로써 테스팅 에러를 어떻게 최소화할 수 있을까? 라는 전체 메인 스트림이 되는 고민들인 거예요.
그 과정에 나오는 게 practical, fractional pooling도 있었고, drop connection, drop out, 뭐, data augmentation, 뭐, patch normalization도. 그러한 메인 어떤 뭐랄까요, 철학, 어떤 필로소피의 하나의, 그러한 필로소피들을 담아냈던 하나의 regularization 테크닉들이었던 거죠. Okay? So, final one is the stochastic depth.
Stochastic depth. So,
in stochastic depth, in training pay, we can skip the sum layer in the network,
like this one. Oh, not this network. Just connect this one, and this one, and this one. So it's going to be just like. Let me draw. Iron 형태겠죠? Something like this one. So by stochastically skipping the sum layer in the network, we can improve the network capacity, right? So passing time, you just use older layer like this one. So this was the paper deep network with the stochastic depth published in ECCB 2016. Recent one is cutout. In this paper, during training, they set random image region to zero, like this one or this one, and this one and this one. So during training, the network tried to extract the feature from this partially occluded region. Partially visible region, or this one, even this one, right? So by doing so, we can improve the capacity of the network. I mean, capacity to extract the informal features from the input image. So this is the cutout technique. Of course, in testing time, they just use the pool image. So this is cut out. Last one is, here's the error. Cut mix. In this paper, train on the random blend of image. So this is image one and image two. They randomly blend the pixel of the pairs during training. For example, in this case, 30% of the cat and 60% of the dog, and then train the network to classify this image as a cat as a 0.4 and dog as a 0.6. So it's going to be the probability. So by using this kind of comics technique, network can extract the 30% of the cat information from here and 60% of the dog information from somewhere, right? So this is a comix technique. Yeah, so comix technique published in 2018, right, in ICLR. Question so far? So today, the only remaining part transfer learning with the CNN. So if you have any questions so far, let me know. Ah. 그러네. 믹스업. 그런 것 같아요. 맞아요. 이거 그쵸. 믹스업이죠, 믹스업. 이 페이퍼가 믹스업이잖아요, 그쵸. 잘못 썼다. 컷아웃 아니고 이게 믹스업이에요. 맞아. 컷믹스라는 것도 책에 나오긴 했는데 여기서 안 다뤘어요. 믹스업이라는 거예요. 맞아. 고마워요. Other question? 오늘 조금 많이 봤죠. 그렇죠? 지금 오늘 본 페이퍼가 10개가 지금 넘어가고 있어요. 그렇죠? 복습을 해야 됩니다.
아마 오늘 끝나고 okay. So today after this class we will have a quiz 4 maybe. So this quiz, I mean the quiz 4 covers the train the neural network part 1 and part 2. So please start to study training neural network. Okay? Okay. So final issue is transfer learning with CNN. The main philosophy looks like this. Let's pre-train our network on the very large scale data and just fine-tuning a few of them, few of the network. Here is the transfer learning with CNN in computer vision application. We generally train our network on the ImageNet dataset. This case, it looks like what is the VG network, maybe? Yeah, VG network. And then, if you have only small data set, just reinitialize this last part at the last epsilon layer and just train that with freezing this remaining thing. Okay? If we have a bigger data, or if we have a bigger data set, train. Let's increase the trainable layer, in this case, the three kinds of things, while freezing these kinds of data, okay? This is just very simple technique, just called the transfer learning. This is very usual in computer vision field. 그런 거죠. 그래서 이제 뭐 당연히 이것도 다른 분야도 마찬가지겠지만, transfer learning이라는 게 이제 모든 데이터를 가지고 처음부터 시작을 하면 너무 안 되니까 어떤 우리가 가지고 있는 very large scale 데이터, 즉 ImageNet 정도의 스케일 데이터로 잘 학습된 피처를 가지고 우리가 원하고자 하는 다운스트림의 어플리케이션 적용해보자라는 거죠. 그렇죠? 그래서 so as we discussed previously, this hierarchical representation of the deep network have a more generic information at the earlier and the more specific feature representation in the last layer. So we can do transfer learning with four kinds of case. The first case, okay, if we have a very little data, but our target data is very, very similar data, then we can just fine tune linear classifier on the top of layer, like this one. If we have a lot of data, then we can just fine tune a few layer, maybe this kind of thing. If we have a very different data set and have lots of data, then just fine tune a larger number of layer, right? Because we have a lot of data. But if we have a very different data set, but very little data, so it could be probabilistic, right? We are troubling, so we have to try linear classifier from different stages. So it could be limitation of the original transfer learning. So there are so many other paper to solve this kind of problem. They just call the domain adaptation or domain generalization technique. Okay, so please check this kind of the technique to improve the limitation of the very little data and very different distribution of the data. I mean, ImageNet or ImageNet and our data. Okay? Okay, so as you know, the transfer learning with the CNN are very progressive. So, for example, in object detection, for example, like this PASTAR CNN case, you don't know yet, but this is just object detection network. In this case, we generally use the CNN CNN network pre-train the ImageNet data set. And another application in image captioning consisting of the CNN RNN. In CNN part, they start from the pre-trained ImageNet. The network parameters start from the CNN pre-trained on the ImageNet and word vectors pre-trained with the word vector. Okay, so transfer learning are very progressive
in deep learning area. Okay, so this is the end of today's lecture. From last week until this week, we discussed how to train our neural network with the advanced technique, for example, like optimization, gradient update rule, or the regularization technique, or what was that? Transfer learning, something like this, right? So yeah, this is the end of training the neural network. And after that, we will move to the computer vision application from next week. And we will talk about what is the most important issues, what are the most important issues in modern computer vision field. Okay? Okay, so this is end of today's lecture. Thank you for listening. Please give me the question. Okay, thank you very much. 질문 있는 사람? 네, 해주셔도 됩니다. 자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자자
끝나지 않았어요? 아닌가? 대학원은 거의 끝나지 않았나? 아니에요? 응나학습 아직 중간고사 기간이에요? 그래요? 언제까지예요? 그쵸? 이번 주까지가 중간고사 할 텐데 아마? 그쵸? 아닌가? 다음 주도 있는 수업은 있을 수도 있고 오케이 알겠습니다. 이번에는 조금 그러면은 여유롭게 한번 해보도록 합시다. 자 봅시다. 스토카스틱스가 왜 정규화 방법인지 궁금합니다. 자 이것도 맞아요. 드랍아웃과 같은 개념을 생각하면 되는데 자 무슨 얘기를 하고 싶은 거냐면 우리의 네트워크 우리가 학습해야 되는 이 네트워크 4개가 모두 다 파이널 아웃풋, 파이널 골을 잘 찾는데 도움이 되길 바라는 거예요. 그러니까 쉽게 생각하면 무임승차하는 모듈들이 없길 바라는 거죠. 그렇죠? 그래서 드랍아웃처럼 비슷한 개념인데 얘네들을 이 스킵 커넥션을 스토카스틱하게 스킵 커넥션을 먹이다 보면 먹이고 이 레이어들에는 연결을 안 해버리는 거죠. 그 말은 뭐냐? 요 한 스텝, 요 한 이터레이션에서는 요 두 개의 모듈이 열심히 이 파이널 아웃풋을 찾는 데 도움을 주려고 노력을 할 거예요. 즉 학습이 되겠죠? 다음 이터레이션에서는 뭐 얘네를 지워지고 뭐 얘가 도움이 된다든지 이렇게 이터레이션을 계속 돌다 보면은 우리가 스토카스틱하게 연결을 시켜서 이렇게 이터레이션 돌면 모든 모듈들이 이 파이널 아웃풋을 위해서 잘 도움을 되도록 학습이 되는 거죠. 이게 이제 저희가 지금 계속 생각했던 모든 개념들이랑 다 비슷한 거예요. 그러니까 뭐 컷아웃도 비슷한 개념인 거고 스쿼트 데프스, 뭐 프랙티컬 폴링이나 드랍 커넥션, 드랍 아웃, 뭐 데이터 고민스 모두 다 같은 얘기를 하고 있는 거예요. 오케이? So, other question? 오케이, so. If not, let's finish today's lecture. Thank you.